We're days away from a monetary policy review, and this one is going to be an interesting one. We're heading into the review with the economist fraternity quite nicely divided, some saying that it isn't time to hike rates yet, others saying that we are a few months away from a hike, and some saying that the hike will come in June itself. Let's get that debate going, because there are many elements to it. There's inflation, there's growth, there's exchange rate. Joining us here on Bloomberg Quint is Sajjid Chinoy of JPMorgan, Indranil Sen Gupta of Bank of America Merrill Lynch. Thank you both so much for coming in today.
Sure.
So, you know, various aspects to the debate, and I'm going to encourage both of you to debate it out without, you know, an anchor butting in. But let me start with your basic views. Sajjid, do you want to kick off with what your view is ahead of the policy?
So I think, you know, I think it's important to have continuity in the framework, and the framework is that this is flexible inflation targeting, but the primary objective is to keep inflation anchored close to 4%. Now, in the last review, the RBI said, and we were surprised that they brought their inflation forecast down to 4.4. Think of what's happened since then. Oil has moved up another 15%. You've had two very strong core inflation prints. Adjusting for housing and making all the adjustments you need to would suggest that input prices have gone up, pricing power is coming back into the system, which is what the RBI surveys say as well. And so in a way, core inflation is today running at 5.2%. Oil is back up, the rupee has weakened, global financial conditions have tightened, and you've got the promise of MSP increases. Even if you make conservative assumptions on those MSP increases, 1 year ahead inflation, which is what I think you should look at, next Jan to March, is now running at 5% or above. So in the infant stages of a new regime, if your medium-term target is 4% and your one-year ahead forecast is 5%, I think that's reason enough to begin to to tighten monetary policy. I'm indifferent about whether they should do this in June or August. I think the case for June would be to be proactive. You know, Indonesia has moved, global financial conditions have tightened. The case for August is there's no real panic. Let's have some more continuity in communication.
Yeah.
Let's use June to change our forecast, change our stance, and prepare markets and raise rates by 25 basis points. But I think it should be done largely because inflation now will be uncomfortably above their 4% benchmark.
Okay, so even on target. Inflation alone, you think it's justified?
That's
and
right.
The core inflation chart will come up on the screen. Indranil, you have a different view on how you see inflation.
So we have, we believe that the RBI should pause in June. Because the bulk of the inflation that we are seeing now is because of base effects. Inflation will cross 5% in June. That's against 2% last year. Take an average, it's 3.5%. The same holds for core inflation. Core inflation came down last year, so it's naturally going up on base effects right now. Once you're past June, maybe into July, into August, we think that the environment changes dramatically towards our October rate cut. Number one, inflation will begin to come down, barring a hump in September. We think inflation goes down towards 4% levels in the second half of the year, and that is where the RBI also came in the last policy, as you know. So that's number one. Number two, we think that we are going to see normal rains, and once it starts pouring, I think the fears of inflation will begin to go away. Number three, growth now will look great because of base effects, you know, 7.5% in the next two quarters, but then it'll start to come down, and then the questions arise that when growth is where it is, should you actually be having yields at these levels? And if global flows do not come, we are actually looking at almost $30 billion of OMOC purchases this year, which should also begin to bring down yields. Finally, you know, when it comes to the rupee, we think that the rate defense never works in India because you have equity flows, which are almost equity investments, FPI equity investments, which are 5x, 6x of bond investments. And we saw what happened, you know, in July 2013 when, you know, the RBI hiked, the rupee went from 59 to 68. My view, and you know, this is a view I had even then, is that it is far better to do NRI bonds.
Okay.
We could get about $35 billion in this time. And that solves, you know, the whole spectrum of problems. You do not have to sacrifice growth. You get FX reserves. And, you know, I've been associated with NRI bonds from 1998. And they have worked on each occasion, whether it's 1998, whether it's 2000, whether it's 2013. So overall, we think that, you know, once the base effects are over, market sentiment will calm down. And, you know, the RBI will find an environment, that tends to a cut in rates.
Okay, I'll come to the FX part in a minute, but on inflation, it's not like you all differ on the trajectory of inflation. It is on where you think that inflation pressure is emerging from and how you deal with it. Is that the difference between your views?
No, I think he has a higher inflation number in the second half of the year. My premise is that, the inflation that you're seeing is largely driven by base effects. If you look at fundamentals, growth is weak. You should read the 7.6 with the 5.6 base. Liquidity is very tight. There are presumably a good monsoon on the way. So I don't see, much of a case for inflationary pressures. Oil is a risk. We as a house think that oil is peaking for now. Even otherwise, the impact on oil is fairly limited in CPI.
So where I differ is, I think, my view is this is not only base effects. So just look at the momentum of core inflation. So, let's be precise about it. Let's take out diesel, petrol, even housing, the cleanest measure of core. In the last 6 months, and this is since October, when you can't say that this is going up because of GST, the monthly momentum of core on average has been about 0.45%, which means annualized is running at 5.5%. I'm not making the case that you're going to have runaway demand or growth in India, that this is not demand-led inflation. That's where we agree. I think that the internals in yesterday's GDP print were much weaker than the headline number. What I'm saying is this is cost push inflation. Yeah. That oil prices are up 50% over the last 9 months. Yeah. The rupee is weaker. Yeah. I think if oil is stronger, then the terms of trade shock reverses, which means you get an equilibrium. The real exchange rate has to depreciate. Hmm. So over time, you get a weaker rupee, higher oil prices, yeah, and the government commitment to push up MSPs. So quite apart from what the monsoon does, the government wants to correct the declining terms of trade for farmers. Even if they succeed only on paddy, which is where they've got most control, that'll push up CPI by 45, 50 basis points. All I'm saying is it's cost push. It's not just base effects, it's momentum. Okay. And economic growth is just strong enough that now you've got some pricing power. If you look at the RBI surveys, they tell you, producers say, costs are up, we can now pass it on. So you just need growth to pick up a little bit to sustain that pricing power. I think that's enough, in my view, to keep inflation close to 5% a year from now.
Okay. Just one more question specific to inflation. In terms of the fact that we are now in an inflation target framework. I think there was an IMF report which questioned how long can low inflation last in Asia. And they had a chart which we'll throw up, which said that if you look at the midpoint, then we have actually not, as we all know, we have not actually met that midpoint. How important is it to the credibility of the framework, especially since we've just started it, Indranil, to come close to and stay close to that midpoint?
I think it's important, but at the same time, Sajjid was a member of the Patel Committee, and the calculation of threshold CPI inflation there was 6.2 to 6.7%. So I think the question is that, by trying to drag inflation down to 4%, are you sacrificing growth more than you should? And I think that, right now it does not matter because the growth environment is weak, but once growth returns, and not just on base effects, you'll probably see inflation drift higher. And that is probably something that you have to accommodate. 2 points. One is that, when you look at MSP price hikes, we think they're not inflationary for the simple reason that the revised MSP price hike, apart from bajra and, one or two crops, is below the ruling market price. So, while the government has raised MSP prices, we do not think it does much either for inflation or for rural demand. So that's one point that I would like to make.
Okay. On the inflation targeting, if we were not in an inflation targeting framework, would we have seen hikes right now?
So a hard one to answer what the counterfactual is, but the fact is we are in this framework.
Yeah.
And I would argue that some of the protective mechanism that we have against the global stress is precisely because we're in this framework. Think back to 2013. Mm. Your inflation is also becomes your anchor for medium-term currency movements. If I'm running 10% inflation year after year, my expectation is in equilibrium, the currency must depreciate 10% a year. And that's what drove the mayhem in 2013. Mm. The fact that we have a commitment to 4% also anchors medium-term currency expectations. Now, how does this work? If you look around the world, inflation targeting works by anchoring expectations. Inflation is very often a function of two things, self-fulfilling expectations and slack. If you can anchor expectations, then the trade-off between activity and prices becomes much more favorable in your world. That any degree of slack results in less movements in prices. So I think it's hugely important in the first 2-3 years of a brand new framework to say, you know what, we have a commitment to be close to 4. No one's arguing to be draconian and say it should be exactly 4%.
Sure, but
also, when all of us agree that output gaps are closing, you know, I'm not in the camp that believes that there is this trade-off between growth and inflation. There could be a two-quarter trade-off. But in the medium term, we've realized keeping inflation low and stable is the best thing you can do to drive medium-term growth potential. So I think in the first couple of years, it's good to be. If in the first year, you're going to make the case that inflation's 5%, but you know what? You know
it's
what?
Okay.
Let me revisit it. Then how can we possibly anchor household, economic agents, inflation expectations? That's why I think, even if it's symbolic, these rate hikes may well be symbolic. We're not calling for more than 1 or 2.
Yeah, actually, I was going to come
They may
come
well
to
be
that,
symbolic
yeah.
because monetary conditions have tightened much more. But it's important to send a message in a turbulent global environment that India is serious about institutional reform on inflation.
Just taking that point, it is nobody's case, even if one sees a rate hike, that we are in a rate hiking extended cycle, right? Because as your report said, your title was give growth a chance. And if everybody is in agreement that growth is still being propped up by government spending, then even if we see rate hikes, probably a shallow, short cycle.
Well, you know, there is a deeper question of whether there is a statistically stable relationship between policy rates and inflation.
Okay.
Because, you know, I think no study that I have seen really finds a relationship between the policy rate and CPI inflation, for the simple reason that
food
is such a huge amount. So in a way, you know, to say that we will hike rates and bring down
in India
inflation is not something that is scientifically proven. Oh. So that's number one.
Sajjid, come on.
No, all I say is, listen, we had the same debate in the committee.
Okay.
And in that report, we've gone out of our way to show that, listen, you're
inflation
right on
expectations
food,
period.
That if you look at core inflation in India, whichever metric you use, that you find a very good fitting Phillips curves. And many economic researchers in India have since found that core inflation is very much a function of inflation expectations and slack. So I agree with the point that food may not be, the direct food impact won't. Core, we think, is. And second round impacts of food inflation also to filter through, but you know, we'll agree to disagree on that.
The next MPC committee or next monetary policy committee. But on growth, very quickly before I come to exchange rate, so growth you think will need support, but you know, so if you do hike perhaps for, you know, rupee plus some inflation reasons, it can't be more than 2 or 3 hikes.
Yeah, you
maybe
know,
not even
my,
3.
See, my thesis for the last few years has been that what is holding back growth is high real lending rates.
Yeah.
So the first thing you got to do is bring down real lending rates. Now what has happened in the last few months is that because your yields have gone up, you have landed in a situation where now your deposit rates are going up, where your lending rates are beginning to go up.
Yeah.
I think in the history of India, the Indian economy, this is the first slack season. This is the first April and May where you're seeing banks raise deposit rates, banks raise lending rates. So I think the primary focus should be to now cool down yields, because unless the risk free comes down, you're not going to be able to bring down lending rates.
That's a banking issue as well, right?
It is a banking issue as well. Now, you know, the point
and
is
a fiscal issue.
And a fiscal issue.
The point is that, you know, in the second half of the year, you have to do massive OMO because flows are not going to come. So maybe you'll be able to bring down yields. Now, you know, if you raise rates, full knowing that there is no link between rates and inflation, and further drive up yields, then you are kind of, you know, doing something that's going to be counterproductive for the economy. And, you know, this is precisely what Bimal Jalan did, which is he kept rates stable. At that time also, there were fears inflation will go up. Nothing happened. What happened as a result? He also did the same NRI bonds. What happened as a result is India led global recovery. Right now, India is, you know, if you look at metrics other than GDP, India is clearly not the leader in global recovery by any sense of the term.
Yeah, and I think he still holds that view. The last time I spoke to him about inflation, he's like, you people are too focused on the second decimal of inflation. Look at, you know, the bigger picture.
But let's analyze why growth has slowed. Let me make the opposite case here. We saw a time in the last 2 years where rates have come down, liquidity was in huge surplus, right? Liquidity was in a massive surplus post demonetization. The RBI cut by 200 basis points. The yield curve became very flat because all that banks did was take these deposits and buy bond yields. Did that really move the needle on growth? Which tells me, is that the binding constraint today? Number one. Number two, look at the data carefully. Where has the growth slowdown come the last year? We've written about this extensively. Net exports.
Yeah,
the real question is, in strongest global growth in 7 years, weakest Indian growth in 4 years because net exports shaved off 150 basis points from growth. Weak exports, strong imports. The real question is, how do you improve the competitiveness of India's economy, right? How do you get back into value chains? How do you improve infrastructure bottlenecks? How do you improve access to credit, the banking system? I think rates may be one small part of that, but I think to say that interest rates are the binding constraint is not the way I see things. If they were, the easing in the last couple of years, both liquidity, yields, rates, should have driven a much bigger growth pickup. It didn't.
Okay, so since you mentioned the export story, so I think you had a note out saying, questioning whether we are facing the Dutch disease, saying that terms of trade were positive, real appreciation was so high that we've become slightly more uncompetitive. That was your basic premise?
Yeah. I was stunned to see, because let me step back, I think to not be alarmist. Firstly, as you enter this period of global stress, let's first all admit India is much more fortified than 5 years ago.
Sure.
Our twin deficits are lower, inflation has collapsed, and our reserve cover is much higher. If you look at FX reserves as a function of your current account deficit next year, even assuming it's 3% of GDP, and your short-term debt, reserve cover today is 1.4 times that it was in 2013. So there's no real panic. That said, when you strip out oil and gold from the current account, I was stunned to see that the current account surplus, ex oil and gold, has deteriorated by 2% of GDP in 4 years. That was stunning to me, right? Over the last 4 years, even as India's growth differential with the rest of the world has reduced, which should improve your external imbalances, they've worsened by 2% of GDP. We think there are many reasons. Again, infrastructure, competitiveness, global value chains. But you've seen a 20% appreciation of the trade-weighted rate before January. Now, that I think is a function of what we went through, that you have this big terms of trade shock. India got 3% of GDP when oil prices fell. Our estimate is 2/3 of that got spent. When that happens, this is typical Dutch disease. The real exchange rate in equilibrium appreciates, right? Because the price of non-tradables goes up faster than the price of tradables. There's nothing that policymakers can do. All you can do is decide this equilibrium real appreciation, either take through nominal appreciation or through higher prices. So the 20% real appreciation, I think, has compounded the fact that the rest of the economy has become more uncompetitive. The reason I'm saying all this is there is a direct policy implication. Yeah. Now, if oil goes back up, the terms of trade reverses. The opposite happens. The equilibrium real rate should depreciate this year. It started. It's down by 5.5% in the first 4 months. Policymakers should not stand in the way of that depreciation, because that is an equilibrium phenomenon to higher oil prices and will help the underlying competitiveness. So what you should do through reserves is slow the pace of that depreciation so there's no panic and no self-fulfilling capital outflows. But what that means here is if the real rate were to depreciate this year, which is good for the underlying economy, there will be inflationary consequences and you meet those through raising policy rates.
Indranil, you want to come in on this? It's an interesting point.
Well, my view, of course, is that global factors are relatively less important in the Indian scheme of things, and domestic demand is obviously far more important. And that, I think, was the traditional Indian response, the RBI's response, if you like, to a global shock, which is to try to stimulate global demand, domestic demand. Now, I think because the RBI got embroiled in battling a rain shock with rates in 2011-2012, we landed in a situation where you had a global slowdown and you engineered a local slowdown. And that is why, what has happened is that you have led to a huge pileup of NPLs. Now, you can say that there is a promoter who did it willingly, there's a promoter who was not wise enough, but ultimately NPLs are a function of the economic cycle. And clearly what the RBI did, let's say 5 years ago, trying to fight, some food shortage by raising rates did not help. And that is why we have, in fact, created a further problem in terms of NPLs. So I think that, at this point in time, the easier thing in my view, and this is something I saw working in 98, I saw working in 2000, is that if you issue non-resident bonds, you are able to stabilize the rupee, you are able to, fend off global inflationary pressures to an extent, and therefore you are also able to keep local rates low and support growth. One point finally I will make about oil is that, you know, when oil is coming off a low base, the inflationary impact of oil is actually much larger than what it really is. For example, you know, suppose oil goes up by $10 from 30 to 40. That has a huge implication on inflation. Whereas when oil goes up from 110 to 120, the inflationary implication is much less, but the damage to the economy is much more. So it is also important to see the level of oil. And you know, because we are coming off 30, 70 looks very alarming. Go back 3 years when we were all in, you know, 100 plus, and if someone had said that, you know, India has an oil problem at 70, you know, people would have said, how is that possible? So my view is that, you know, therefore, like I'm saying, that I think everything should be done to keep rates low, the way we did in 98 to 2004, and something that paid us such rich dividends, and you know, try to protect any external imbalances by building up FX reserves.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Just to say, I think, you know, on the NRI bond, I take a slightly different view.
Yeah, and you guys have different views. So, I mean, you know, both of you had reports out on the numbers. So are you looking at the stock and the flow? Because you said about 50% is interest rate sensitive with flows. And your numbers look very different. Are you looking at the stock? Because you said only stock. 80 billion is...
So 80 billion is you're looking bonds at stock. And 450 billion is...
So I think both things can be true at the same time. One is that last year, the year that just ended, there were $76 billion of capital flows. 38 billion were what we call interest rate sensitive, which is government bonds, corporate bonds, banking capital, and ECBs. Right? Don't take the NRI deposits in there.
Yeah.
This year, if the current account deficit is 80 billion, which is our estimate under oil at 75, and this has been conservative, we assume exports pick up, imports slow, gold is only 40 billion. FDI flows can be stronger and be 35. NRI deposits give you about 10 to 12. You still need 30 billion more. Those last year were interest rate sensitive. If global rates are going up, Indian rates have peaked, the interest rate differential narrows, can we get 30 billion more? So we may well be in a situation where the BOP is in a deficit. The RBI has sold, I think, 5 billion in the month of April, $4.5 billion. But the big difference, we should not panic. You know, around the world, there is a sense the central bank has a war chest of FX reserves, unlike 2013. It's 420 billion and counting. And they are willing and prepared to use it. Hmm. The issue I have with the bond is if early on in the process, India says, you know what, NRI bond, that will be a panic. That,
exactly.
Oh my goodness!
Exactly, betray a sense of
the
nervousness.
The central bank
won't you?
Knows
Unless
something
it's a
we
policy.
Don't know. You've got such a war chest of reserves. If we are to lose $20 billion in a year of global turmoil on a base of 420, so be it. But if you start saying, you know, NRI bond, people say, oh my God, the current account must be worse. The NIIP position must be worse. The short-term debt must be worse. The central bank knows something we don't know. Argentina had that problem. You start late. Yeah. Turkey had to raise rates 300 basis points because they move late.
If we had started to do this as a policy, for instance, if we had done an overseas bond 3 years back and we were doing tranches, it would have been better, right? I mean, if you do it now, you...
First hint of stress.
Yeah.
See, I'll give you two examples. Huh. What I am very influenced by.
Okay.
In 2000, when you had, you know, the 9/11, Vimal Jalan and Dr. Reddy went and did a India Millennium Deposit while the RIBs were running, right? What happened is we got in money, the rupee was stable, we protected growth. Later on, at that time people said that, oh my God, others are going, NRIs are going to make money. Later on, you know, it became a model for how an emerging market country can fend off a global crisis. Cut to 2012-13. In April 2012, I started writing about NRI bonds when the rupee was 52. At that time, it was that who says we do not have high FX reserves? Who says there is a problem? Finally, you go and do the same thing at 69, 1.5 years later. So I leave it to you to judge which is wiser. You know, a stitch in time saves nine.
Fair point. I have time for one last question. So I'm going to bring it to mundane stuff. Sorry. But this is a fabulous discussion. So if the RBI were to or the MPC were to hike, communication will have to be very deftly managed, right? Because the market is already nervous. Yields already elevated. On top of that, you come with a rate hike. Do you sort of complicate the problem even more?
So maybe I'll take a contrarian view. I think if you get a hike in June, it should be a slightly dovish hike. Okay. Because what you don't want on the basis of these financial conditions is for markets to say the RBI has hiked in June, this must mean there are three or four hikes in the pipeline.
Okay.
So if you're hiking, it should be, I'm being preemptive, I'm being proactive, I can see inflation at 5%, I want to move sooner in this global environment. If you don't hike in June, it has to be a very hawkish hold.
Okay.
That I'm preparing the ground, I just want to resolve the uncertainty with MSPs in the monsoon, but we'll have to do something. I don't think much will have to be done this year, 25 to 50 basis points, given where we currently are. But yeah, I think it'll be good to just anchor market expectations, investor expectations that the central bank will not fall behind the curve. Okay. At the same time, we'll not tighten monetary conditions so much that kind of, you know, defeats the purpose.
Okay, Indranil, I know what your preference is, that they don't hike and they actually cut, but should they be moving in that direction? How do they handle it?
See, I think the first thing is that, you know, then you have to change your inflation forecast. Because if you come the last time and cut inflation forecast by, what, 50 basis points? Okay. And then the next time, you know, go and hike, that is, I think, an inconsistency. Or you have really, really compelling reasons to say that, okay, 2 months ago, I cut my inflation by 50 basis points. 2 months later, I am hiking it again, despite a good monsoon. So there has to be that consistency of communication.
The only thing I will say is that in those 2 months, oil has gone up another $10. Yeah. The RBI's own estimates say every $10 pushes up my forecast by 20 to 30 basis points. The rupee is down 4%, and I've got two very strong core inflation prints. And more conviction now that at least growth has recovered. I think the 7.7% number is deceptively strong, but more conviction that there is a recovery. So, but I agree with Indranil that if they end up in June raising their inflation forecast, changing their stance from neutral to withdrawal of accommodation, and sounding suitably cautious for a rate hike in August, that's fine too.
All right. Thank you both so much. I think this is a microcosm of the debate that will happen in the MPC. So appreciate you joining us.
Sure.
Thanks for watching Bloomberg Quick.